Welcome, everyone. My name is Dawn Lay. I run equity derivatives sales at the ASX. In this session, I have the privilege of leading a panel of subject matter experts from the ASX. Over the next 30 to 40 minutes, we will showcase the equities ecosystem in Australia, from listings to cash market trading, investment products, and derivatives. So firstly, let me introduce our panelists today. We have James Posnett from the listings team, Rob Nash, Head of Equities Relationships Management covering our cash equities market, Martin Dinn, Senior Investment Product Specialist, and Graham O'Brien, Head of Equity Market Sales and Equity Derivatives. So guys, let's get started. It has certainly been an interesting year, to say the least. It would be great to get a good understanding of what has happened in 2021 in each one of your businesses. James, let's start with you. In the last update, you spoke about the strong pipeline for the remainder of the year. Has this played out, and what have you seen in terms of IPO activity recently?
Thanks, Dawn. Well, look, I'm pleased to say market conditions have been favourable, and most of that IPO pipeline has been executed. 2021 was really a year of records in the listings business. The IPO market globally has recorded all-time highs in terms of number of IPOs and capital raised. It's also been a standout year for ASX IPOs, with over $11 billion in capital raised, which is the highest level in 7 years. There have been around 200 new listings, which is the biggest year since the height of the mining boom and bull market of 2007. And by volume of listings, ASX has again outperformed most exchanges globally, just behind those in the world's largest economies, the US and China. Several factors have driven investor demand for IPOs over the past few months. Firstly, government stimulus has clearly helped propel markets to all-time highs. We've also seen M&A activity at its highest level in over 10 years. A significant level of buybacks and special dividends have also helped put cash back into the hands of investors, which has then been redeployed. The growing superannuation pool, of course, has continued to provide tailwinds to the IPO market and the equity market more generally. It has also been a record year for billion-dollar IPOs. We are on track for a total of 8. And the largest IPO of the year was Florida-based asset manager GQG, at just under $6 billion in market cap. We've seen IPOs across multiple sectors, from technology and financials to healthcare and industrials. It was pleasing to see particularly tech IPOs, SiteMinder and PEXA come to market, as well as fintechs Judo Bank and Pepper Money. And similar types of companies are looking to list on the market in the coming months. On the healthcare side, we've had the largest biotech IPO ever in Clarity Pharmaceuticals. And as in 2020, the highest volume of listings has been in the mining sector, with explorers accounting for over half of all new listings. This reflects elevated prices in commodities like gold, copper, lithium, and nickel. At the opposite end of the market, 29 Metals was ASX's biggest ever copper IPO. We're also on track for 20 international listings this year, including 5 from New Zealand. So overall, Dawn, a great year for IPOs on ASX.
Yeah, that's great news, James. Thank you. Now, Rob, moving to cash equities. At our last gathering earlier in the year, you highlighted some really interesting trading behaviour by retail clients. Has there been any changes since then? And can you give us give us an update on what you've been seeing?
Thanks, Dawn. Yeah, it's certainly been a certainly an interesting 6 months. We'll start off by having a look at this the overall turnover of the equity market on this chart here. Just want to highlight there that the last 6 month trend that we've seen has been really consistent, and I want to really specifically point out the months of August and September of this year as really standouts. The overriding view of the catalysts behind this has been numerous, but really, the knock-on effects of what we've seen from as economies and countries slowly reawaken post their COVID lockdowns has seen a ripple effect felt right across their economies, particularly around supply chains and logistic bottlenecks. It's causing price rises on a lot of commodities. So we're seeing an inflationary response, particularly at the headline level. That's triggering into central bank conversations around tapering, and those intentions are actually having some quite volatile effects of interest rates right around the markets, particularly at the short end of the curve. So any change to interest rate sensitivity has a really strong knock-on effects to the Australian market, particularly around resources and financials, and that's clearly what we've seen over the last few months. Some of the other things around, if you want to sort of step back from inflation and interest rates that we've talked about, we've seen some really big volatility in iron ore prices, particularly over the last three, 4 months. Iron ore peaked around $230 a ton around the middle of the year, and it's fallen to about $85 a ton just in the last couple of weeks. So that's a huge move, and as we'll talk about in a few slides later, had a really big response from the retail trading community, and particularly around some of our major corporate events. Just on those corporate events, just taking on that message that James mentioned about capital market activity. I do want to really emphasize that has been one of the probably the most single biggest direction from the local perspective with regards to capital management as well as M&A. We've had some of the biggest off-market buybacks announced through from CBA. We've had special dividends, and that's obviously all on top of the buybacks that have been announced, and we'll touch on that in further slides. So that's the overall turnover. Just quickly on the second slide there about institutional, really want to have just two messages here, breaking down the overall market into two segments of institutional and retail. Quickly looking at institutional, we've seen that as a proportion of overall activity reclaim some of that market share that it lost back to above that 85% level, mostly around those corporate events that we just talked about, particularly around the iron ore volatility and interest rate moves around the banks. And the third slide there is literally the flip side of what we see in an institutional. You could almost turn it upside down and it will match it exactly. The percentage of retail turnover in nominal dollars actually has gone up, but as a percentage of overall activity, just not keeping pace with the institutional market. And as a result of that, retail proportion of overall activities dropped back to around that 15% level. That is a good level, Dawn, and whilst it's still below the 20% level we saw in February earlier this year around the GameStop and meme activity, it's still at actually a pretty good level overall. And in the coming questions and slides, Dawn, we'll go into a little bit more detail about that.
Thanks, Rob. Good insights. So let's move on to the ETF side of the market. Martin, it would be really good to get an understanding on how investors have used ETFs to navigate the volatility in markets in 2021.
Yeah, thanks, Dawn. 2021, phenomenal year for ETFs. ETF FUM currently sitting at $124 billion and up almost 70% over the last 12 months. Now, in terms of how investors are using ETFs, we've seen investors use ETFs in such a diverse range of ways, which really shows the versatility of the ETF structure. Firstly, we've seen investors use ETFs to take advantage of the rebound of the global economy, with investors taking a risk-off approach and flocking to equity ETFs. Over the last 12 months, we've found that 75% of new money coming into ETFs were coming from equity ETFs. And really interestingly, this was the first time in 7 years that there wasn't a fixed income ETF in the top 10 most popular ETFs of the year. Now, secondly, we've also seen a record number of investors flock into ESG ETFs, and this is as more investors look to invest in areas of the market that align with their values, as well as profit from companies. They're at the forefront of developing technologies to help countries achieve their net zero emission goals. And look at the numbers. Since the beginning of the year, we've seen investors pour over $2.1 billion into ESG ETFs, which is more than 58% higher than those levels in 2020. Thirdly, we've also seen investors flock into thematic ETFs, such as cloud computing, battery technology, semiconductors, cryptocurrency, and cybersecurity ETFs, as investors look to take a bet on these long-term megatrends. Since the beginning of the year, investors have poured in over $2.3 billion into thematic ETFs, And noting that this excludes broad-based ESG ETFs, which is more than 1.5 times higher than those levels in 2020. The final thing is that we've seen an incredible number of investors flock into mixed asset ETFs, as more investors, they're looking for that one-stop shop solution to building a portfolio. Now, over those last 12 months, we've seen $1.5 billion of new money go into mixed asset ETFs, which is more than 2.5 times higher than that number last year. Now, what was really interesting was for the first time in ETF history, we saw a mixed asset ETF rank in the top 10 most popular ETFs of the year, that being the Vanguard Diversified High Growth Index ETF. Now, really, to put that all together, it's been a huge year for ETFs. And what's really stood out to me is that ETF growth has really come from a diverse range of areas, which really shows the versatility of the ETF structure.
That's really interesting, Martin. Thank you very much for that update. And Graham, how has 2021 been for the equity derivatives market?
It's been a great year, Dawn, for equity derivatives. So still that $9 billion that we see in daily value traded in the equity derivatives market. And I'll quickly touch on some of the products that we have at ASX in equity derivatives and some of the growth that we've seen in those products themselves. So we have those 6 index futures trading around $7 billion a day. Obviously, the main contract being the S&P ASX 200 index futures, or SPY as we all know it in Australia. But really growing is the gross total return futures contract. So that's the contract itself that includes dividends within its pricing. Obviously, that particular contract itself growing to $2 billion throughout the year, still at that $1.5 billion in open interest. So some really good growth in our index futures suite. We have 83 single stocks, and that's where lots of change has happened in the ASX market this year. And I'm going to touch on that in a moment or two's time. We have our 2 index options over that same index, S&P ASX 200, and we have our low exercise price options or share futures. But there's been lots and lots of change in our options market. We started off the year, first quarter of rebating all on-screen activity in our options market, all those fees that that our brokers pay, rebating it back to them for that on-screen activity to boost liquidity back into the options market. That coupled with single stock options price fee changes to make it much more appetizing for trading in lower dollar stocks, a new market making scheme providing lots more liquidity to the marketplace, has really grown the activity that we've seen in the options market, especially amongst retail investors. I've already touched on that gross total return futures contract. We continue to see new growth and lots of new single stock options that we've introduced to the market quite recently. Some of those that have really outperformed, Zip getting into that tech sector in our single stock options market, and Independence Gold really getting on that resources tune that we've seen across the equities market, with over 1.5 million contracts trading in those since they've come to the marketplace. What we really have seen across our market, more and more, we've seen corporate actions really impacting our options market. Lots of corporate activity and adjustments to contract sizes off the back of special dividends and obviously the M&A activity that both Rob and James touched on earlier. But really exciting year so far for equity derivatives.
It is really encouraging to hear about the gross total return future increasing in volume, and you know, really the market noticing what the changes we've made in the options market. So thanks, Graham. So James, you touched on a number of international companies who have listed on the ASX. How do we position ourselves against global exchanges, and what is the advantage of an ASX listing for companies from overseas to come to us?
Yeah, look, that's a very good question. We've been actively promoting ASX overseas for a number of years now. There have been about 100 international IPOs on ASX over the past 5 years, and about a quarter of those have been in the technology sector. Now, this has really helped diversify the menu of investment opportunities on the market by sector and, of course, by geography. On a global basis, ASX competes particularly well in small and mid-cap listings, which is demonstrated in terms of things like valuation, liquidity, analyst coverage, and access to capital. Now, at a high level, clearly a key driver is Australia's large pension market. But it's also about having the right settings in place like enabling early index inclusion and having an efficient capital raising framework. Australian investors have leading expertise in a number of areas, from fintech to mining, and ASX has a strong list of peer groups in most industry sectors. So all of these things together make ASX an appealing option for international companies looking to raise capital. Now, the international listings generally fall into three broad categories. The first category includes listings from smaller countries that have limited access to capital locally in private or public markets. So countries like New Zealand, Singapore and Ireland. The second is the US, where companies may prefer to be listed rather than take private equity or venture capital funding, but are not large enough to justify the regulatory costs or gain enough attention in the US public markets. And the third category is where ASX is simply more attractive than the home market, based on those key metrics that I mentioned earlier. So this year, around half of all international listings were dual listed on their home exchange in addition to ASX, and about half chose ASX as their sole listing venue. Looking ahead, we can expect to see more international listings next year, and now borders are reopening, we look forward to resuming travel to those key markets.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. Thanks, James. And yeah, looking forward to those borders reopening. Now, Martin, you talked about a few thematic ETFs just before, the semiconductor, the hydrogen, the video game ETFs. Do you want to expand on that a little bit?
Yeah, absolutely, Dawn. I mean, I've just provided a slide there that just shows you the growth just to give you a bit of context. But I think what's really interesting about the thematic ETFs is actually the amount of product development in this space. Now, for example, since the beginning of the year, we've seen six thematic ETF launches onto the ASX, which covered a range of themes, which you just mentioned, you know, semiconductors, clean energy, cryptocurrency, and the cloud computing sector. And to me, what was one of the most notable things is that all these ETFs immediately attracted interest from investors. They collectively saw $400 million in new money in 2021. Noting that this figure also excludes $128 million new inflow into CRIP, which only recently just listed. And speaking of CRIP, CRIP has actually been the most successful ETF launch ever, with investors trading just under $40 million in one day, in its first day. And that actually shattered the previous record by eight times and has already broken the maiden ETF monthly inflow in monthly info record. Yeah, so a lot of records. But interestingly though, you know, thematic ETFs, they actually generally take a bit of time before investors flock into them because they get a bit skeptical about the uncertainty around the performance and whether the theme is a fad or a trend, you know. And looking at an example, HACC, which is a thematic ETF that invests in companies in the cybersecurity sector, and ACDC, which is an ETF that invests in companies in the production of battery technology, they've actually been two of the most popular ETFs this year. But what you might not know is that they had a very, very slow start when they first listed. They only accumulated $65 million in new money in its first 2 years of listing. So overall, it does seem like over the last 12 months, investors are becoming increasingly confident in jumping just straight right in and using thematic ETFs to build a portfolio.
Yeah, that's really interesting, Martin. Thank you for that. Now, Rob, following on from the previous questions on retail trading behaviour, is there anything you've noticed about stocks or sectors they've been particularly active in?
Yeah, thanks, Dawn. I think just sort of trying to bring some of the themes here that all of us here on the panel have touched on. By far and away, that element around corporate activity and capital market activity has probably been the highlight of the retail activity for the last 3-4 months. I've just put a couple of suggestions on the slide here. By far and away, the single most traded security by a long way. I don't think I've actually seen the margin. There's been Fortescue Mining. Now, we touched on earlier about the strength of the iron ore market and how much volatility we've seen in the iron ore price. That's obviously translated into the three big iron ore names here, BHP, Rio, and obviously Fortescue. The capital markets angle of it is we've seen record dividends from those companies as well. So the retail activity have been chasing quite substantial, fully franked dividends from these guys, particularly Rio, that paid over a $2.50 special dividend on top of already their very high dividend at the moment. So we've got a really unique confluence of events here where some of the resource stocks are paying a fully franked dividend well in excess of some of the more traditional high paying names, like to say the financials or the REITs at the moment. So that's been a dominant factor of the retail activity around the stocks that they've been buying. The other corporate activity that really highlighted for this quarter over the last few months has been the Afterpay transaction that we talked about. Afterpay, it goes without saying, a very, very well-held retail name. That's been under takeover by Square out of the US. A lot of the funding of all of these stocks they've been buying has been coming out some of the banks. We saw a $6 billion off-market buyback from CBA, and just some of the other stocks that have had a pretty good performance between NAB and CSL over the last 3-4 months. The second major highlight to mention about the retail activity, Dawn, again, I really want to emphasize that something that's really unique for the last 3-4 months is that we've seen retail activity really dominant in the M&A space. Now, a lot of these transactions take months to conclude. Some of them are very highly conditional and may never actually reach their conclusion. And retail investors are acting early and are recycling that capital back into the market and also back into some of these fresh IPOs that James mentioned earlier. And I've just listed there just some of the corporate names and the takeovers that have just happened in the last few months. So retail traders and retail brokers are very, very active this last few months.
Thanks, Rob. That actually leads me into the next question for Graham pretty easily, because we've certainly seen an uplift in retail activity. So in the equity derivative space, Graham, have you seen a change in customer activity? So as you mentioned before, there has been a big uplift in single stock option volumes. Maybe you could touch on some of the strategies you've seen the market using at the moment.
Yeah, for sure. We have seen that uplift, as you suggest, in retail activity. And it's all about hunger for information to start. So lots of activity at the ASX in rebuilding our websites around the options knowledge hub, generating that options trading game, and really delivering customer education around the strategies that they want to hear about. And the three most popular trading strategies we're seeing at the moment from retail customers are income writing, so selling calls over stock that they own to generate income over and above dividends, to selling puts to try and pick up some stock below the market. We're often seeing clients that get caught away from selling calls. They have to sell their stock because the market's rallied, then going on to sell a put to try and pick that stock back up if the market dips back down. And underpinning that entire strategy is portfolio protection. So using some of that income that they're receiving from writing options and getting income from the options market to buy portfolio protection just in case we have another March 2020 and a big correction in the market, just trying to protect the value of their portfolios. Really what we're seeing in the retail space is writing income, using income to protect their shares.
Okay, great. Thanks, Graham. So lastly, guys, what's on the horizon for each one of your business areas for 2022, I guess? So James, it sounds like this year has seen particularly strong momentum in the IPO market. What is the listings outlook for the next year?
Yeah, look, over the coming months, global markets are likely to be dealing with inflationary pressures. But as long as volatility remains at reasonable levels, we will see IPOs executed. But I must say that the listings pipeline is still very strong. And I should also say the year isn't over yet. We've still got 30 listings on the way before Christmas. There are a lot of sort of mining explorers in the pipeline still. So that sort of trend will continue. But we've got a range of sort of companies from sort of technology to healthcare, consumer and real estate sectors represented in that pipeline. And as Rob mentioned, of course, the most significant company in the pipeline is US payments giant Square, which is scheduled to commence trading on ASX early in the new year, subject to completion of the Afterpay acquisition. And this is really an important listing and a strong endorsement of the ASX tech sector globally. And also the Afterpay journey highlights how tech companies can use ASX to fund their growth from an early stage right through to becoming multi-billion dollar success stories. So overall, lots to look forward to in listings in 2022.
Good to hear, James. Thank you so much for that update. Now, Martin, you mentioned Bitcoin before, and in our last panel discussion, this probably got the most questions, to be honest. So maybe you could update us on what the ASX's prospects of a Bitcoin ETF are.
Yeah, sure thing, Dawn. Yeah, Bitcoin has just received so much interest. We saw a Bitcoin ETF, futures-based ETF listed in the US. It traded nearly $1 billion, I think over $1 billion in one day. That's just phenomenal, you know, to see that sort of success. So there's a lot of pent-up demand for it. But in terms of the prospects, you know, of a Bitcoin ETF, I think it's pretty positive. The regulator, ASX, they've recently completed their consultation on quoting a Bitcoin ETF. And really, that's provided us with a pathway forward to quote a Bitcoin ETF. Now, in terms of what that pathway forward looks like, ASIC have provided a list of criteria and what they expect from a Bitcoin ETF. And these criteria includes strict guidelines around the custody of assets, ensuring service providers are available and willing to support a Bitcoin ETF, and also that there's sufficient disclosure around the risk of investing in crypto assets. Now, interestingly, ASIC have actually made it very clear that they will limit crypto assets to those with a robust and transparent pricing mechanism, and also where there's a relevant futures market as well. And what does that mean? It means that at the present moment, it looks like it could only be, an ETF can only be, well, you can only invest in Bitcoin and Ether or put that into an ETF. So in the coming year, what we're really focusing on is developing that robust framework to ensure that our assessment of Bitcoin ETFs meet ASIC's criteria. And really to do this, we're going to work very closely with the fund managers and internal stakeholders to ensure that their Bitcoin ETF meets ASIC's criteria. We also have a lot of work in terms of updating our onboarding documents and working on a number of major rule changes to allow the admission of ETFs to hold crypto assets. So our goal is really to work towards listing a Bitcoin ETF sometime in 2022. And to me, it's really exciting as, you know, we think that the quotation of a Bitcoin ETF will bring many benefits to the investment community, because it's really going to simplify that process of buying and selling Bitcoins, as investors will be able to access Bitcoin in the same way they do with buying and selling shares. You know, and a Bitcoin ETF will also help reduce admin work as well for managing crypto assets, as all these holdings will be put into that single place, you know, such as your shares, which makes things such as rebalancing a lot easier. And finally, a Bitcoin ETF, it solves one of the main issues or some of the main issues with holding crypto assets, such as private keys, security and storage, as all of this will be outsourced to the ETF provider. So really, in summary, the pathway forward is set for us, and we do have a very busy year ahead of us to help quote a Bitcoin ETF. So definitely watch this space.
Yeah, it's really great to hear all of the work you're doing in that space. And like you said, watch this space. We look forward to it. Rob, so it would not be a normal update from you if we didn't get a comment or two on the closing auctions. What trends have we seen, and any specific trading events you want to highlight?
Yeah, thanks, Dawn. You're right. The closing auction continues to be regarded as one of the best in the market, particularly across Asia. The slide that's up on the screen right now looks at the top 10 closing auctions in our history. And the bar there, second from the left from the September expiry, shows that it continues to be the case. We had the second highest we've ever had, just over $7.8 billion of trading activity. One of the most common questions that we get, both from clients domestically and particularly globally, is the search for liquidity and liquidity at good spreads. And our auction continues to do that around these major monthly and quarterly rebalancing events. And they continue to get more and more focus in size. I've just put there at the bottom of the slide there, because it's a common question we do get, Dawn, that as a percentage of total turnover on those expiry days or index rebalance days, should I say, that the closing auctions tend to be around 45% of the total market turnover. So, you know, any institution out there that's got a lot of transactions to do at low market impact tend to gravitate towards our closing auctions. So we continue to see really, really good feedback from our customers on the success and the efficiency of our closing auction.
Okay, thanks, Rob. Always good to hear about that from you. And lastly, Graham, what does 2022 have in store for the equity derivatives market?
2022 for the options market, Dawn. It's all around bringing more OTC trades to exchange. We're seeing lots of client interest around equity flex clear and new customers signing up to the wholesale client agreements to be able to utilise that particular service. It's also expanding our product set. So looking at other international markets that we might be able to give clients exposure to via our options market, and that's via our options over international ETFs, with the expectation for those to be available in the very first quarter of 2022, with the potential to maybe expand into other asset classes via the ETF market as well as the year goes by. It's also about trying to improve the settlement price that we have within our options market. One of the things that's really helped that to this point is the extra liquidity that we're getting from market makers and really giving the market the confidence that our end of day prices and the volatility surfaces that we're using at the exchange to value those options contracts is robust, and the more we can have on-screen pricing, more liquidity on screen can help that. But as I said, OTC to exchange and clearing on exchange to expand our product set via international ETFs and really improving our volatility services at the exchange are some of our key focus items for 2022.
Yeah, some really exciting initiatives there, Graham. Look, thank you all so much for your time and insights today. And thank you to all of those that are listening. Please don't hesitate to get in touch with any further information any of you may need. Thanks so much.